Hello everyone, I figured it was time that I answered Sargon of Akkad's 8 questions for the alt-right, because I was going to do a video on what precisely the alternative right-wing movement is, but it's kind of hard to pin down, I need a little bit more time to do that. So let's go ahead and get into the questions, and most of this will be my own personal opinion, and I'm sure that there are those within the movement that agree with me and disagree with me. But this is from my own personal perspective. As we all know, the alternative right is not a political party or political movement. It's simply an amalgamation of right-wing thinking. And the first question is, are Jews oppressing white people? And of course, this goes back to the JQ, which is a prominent part of the alt-right movement and how people discuss ideas. It always turns back to the question of Jewish supremacy and how it influences our society. But the alternative right is not based in anti-Semitism in any way. And the usage of the term oppressing, I think, is a form of entrapment for the alt-right. Because, of course, he's using the sort of leftist SJW language, sort of black nationalist language against us in order for us to agree. It's a trap. I'm not going to fall for that. It's an emotionally charged word. We all know what it means when we're talking about politics. But no, there is no, it's not about inherent Jewish oppression of other people. It's about questioning the validity of foreign influence on our society, culture, government, economics, what have you. I think it's absolutely important that every group of people on this earth question the motivations of foreigners, because there is always someone in this world who is trying to get a leg up above you. And as we all know, most of the world works on this idea of some form of nationalism, whether it's racial or civic or whatever. They're always trying to advance their group over somebody else. So you need to be wary of foreign influence. Now, we all know that there is a Jewish ethnostate and that it requires lots of outside funding from the United States and Europe and so on and so forth. So when we have very powerful Zionist lobby groups within our societies, we have to question what their motives are when they come to politics. If they are in favor of wars in the Middle East, we need to consider the fact that they may want us to pay for this war that they want so they can expand their territory. You know, why should the United States expend blood and resources in order to gain land for Israel? It doesn't make any sense as far as I'm concerned. Of course, we must also recognize that there are cultural shifts that have happened within our society that have been pushed by people of Jewish descent, whether or not it's inherent to their Jewish identity or not. We have to realize that this is going on and it's changing us, as many in the alt-right would say, is not a positive force. The next question is, should interracial couples be forced to separate? And I assume we're operating from the framework of the ethno-state, or some form of future where the alternative right gains some kind of political action. But if we're talking about, in particular, the ethnostate, which I should say is only one section of the alternative right as a whole, this idea of wanting to form an ethnostate somewhere in the world, it is only one section of the overall philosophy and politics of this movement. But if it were up to me and I was in an ethnostate and I was in a position of power, I would not force these couples to separate. Of course, if their intention as a couple is to have a child, I want that child, no matter what, to grow up to be a functioning member of some society. However, if I am in an ethnostate and there are mixed race couples, I would encourage them to return to the country of origin of their partner, because we simply do not want these types of people in our society. Whether or not you think that it's miscegenation is degenerate or is bad for the gene pool or whatever, you still shouldn't forcefully separate people. And instead, you should encourage them to return to whatever country of origin it may be, and that we don't approve of this type of behavior. I've always been in favor, not in the enforcement of moral values through the state, encouraging people to act a certain way through the state, that would be paternalism, but instead enacting these types of policies through culture, which is enforcement through social norms. For example, we all know that we have the freedom to associate with whoever we want to, right? We can interact and maintain friendships and form relationships with whoever we want to. And if there are those within our society that are acting not in accordance with our belief systems, we can exclude them from our society. So If you don't like miscegenation and you don't want people to do it, simply state publicly, openly, say that you don't want these people, you refuse to interact with them, you refuse to do business with them, so on and so forth, if you don't want that in your society. It does not need to be legislated by the state. I think that's a negative thing. Now, there are, of course, some more authoritarian types that would disagree with me. That's fine. We can have that discussion amongst ourselves. But no, in general, I think it's better to reduce the power of the state in some areas as much as possible. The third question is, should the government prevent citizens from leaving the country? And again, it's sort of the same thing. I don't want the government to force people to sort of make these decisions. I think that if we come together as a collective and say, hey, we want to live here, we want these values to remain, we don't want people to act a certain way or we will not associate with them. If people want to leave and go somewhere else, they are free to do so. However, we can, as soon as someone leaves, we have every right to say that we're not going to accept them back into the country, for example. If someone wants to travel to a place that has a high rate of sexually transmitted diseases or some kind of disease, then if they leave and go there, we can tell them before they leave, hey, if you go there, we're not going to let you back in. We're not going to allow even the possibility of you transmitting some disease from an outside group to our in-group. So those are the types of things you can think of. You don't explicitly have to use the power of the state to force people to stay where they are. And in fact, I think, again, that is a negative force. Question number four is, should the state control education? And again, I think that people should have the choice to do whatever it is they want to with their own children. Now, we can come together as a collective, again, and sort of make these decisions amongst ourselves. Say, hey, we want our children to be raised with a certain set of values, and these values are best served forming in the home between the parents and the child and not with the state. I think that that's a much stronger bond than state-run or state-controlled education. Now, that is not to say that I am against the state providing education for people of lower class. I'm not inherently against that. However, I don't think that government-mandated schools or government-only schools is a positive thing. In fact, I think that's a very negative thing. Because, as we understand, the family unit is the basis of society. And if you want values to persist through culture, or you want a certain type of religion, or whatever, these types of ideas have to start in the home. You have to have positive parenting in order to enforce these values. And as if a child grows up in the right conditions, they will maintain the values that their parents hold. Question number five is, should the state control the media? And again, it's the same sort of answer. I don't believe that the state should have ultimate authority over the media. I think the state should recognize that private media institutions are more powerful forms of good than they could ever have. I think that publicly funding media is sort of a bad idea. You know, I don't want my money going to a media organization that isn't going to promote my values. So forcing people to pay for that is kind of a bad thing. Maybe if we can come together as a collective force and say, hey, we want something like NPR to only represent these values, and I will only give up my tax money if these media companies are representing these values, maybe we could do something like that in a more perfect society. But ultimately, no, the state should not control the media. And question number six is, should the state control the economy? Again, I'm going to reiterate here, just so we're on the same level, it is not within the best interest of the people for the state to regulate the economy very heavy-handedly. Now, of course, we have to recognize that there are people in this world who will take advantage of our weakness if we're not aware of this. For example, the sort of trade deficits between countries. If we're getting a bad deal, we need to go back and revoke these trade deals or find a way to get out of it or protect ourselves, protect our producers within the country to prevent people from leaving their jobs or shipping jobs overseas. We need to make sure that our economy is strong and that we play the game appropriately, because there are people in this world who do not play fairly, who do not play by the rules of free market economies. They are going to surpass us eventually if we don't recognize that sometimes you have to break the rules in order to defend yourself. But again, I think that the regulation of the economy is bad, and ultimately, a free market economy will provide the strongest, most prosperous society, but we have to play by reality and figure out when it is appropriate to apply the state's force into the economy. And the seventh question is one that I don't particularly understand. I'll try and answer it as best as I can, but it is, do the decisions of individual whites matter to the alt-right goals? My response is, of course, the opinion or actions of individual whites matter. This is primarily a white advocacy group, not a supremacist organization. Of course not. There are only some fringe factions within this that are supremacists, but this is simply a white advocacy group on the surface level. In fact, I would say the best thing about the alternative right as it stands right now is that it's not some codified movement, that in general, the only thing that we're trying to do right now is wake up this idea of racial consciousness, provide to the people this idea that it's okay to be who you are and proud of who you are. Everyone else does it, and if we don't do it, then there will be severe consequences. And another great thing about this individual decision-making is that we are teaching young men and women how to better themselves without enforcing it through the state, hopefully. But constantly, when you go into these right-wing circles, what's the first thing that someone tells a new person? It's sort yourself out, eat right, exercise, read more, improve yourself, find a woman or man of high quality, and produce children in a stable environment. Those are the primary things that these right-wing circles are telling people, hopefully. I would, at least, if someone was new to the movement. I would say, sort yourself out first, and then worry about the politics and economics as you become more well-read. So absolutely, the decisions of these individuals matter very much. Just because we want to empower ourselves as a racial collective does not mean that individual decisions don't matter. And I think that's ultimately where this question is going. He's saying, will we stomp on individuals in order to protect the collective? And I think that's a completely different discussion, and this is a terribly framed question. And the final question, question number 8, is an interesting one that I don't get asked very often. And that is, should women have a role in public life? And I would say, absolutely. It's fundamental that women have a role in public life because they serve a distinct purpose in helping hold our society together. You know, I've always said that traditional masculinity is not about putting women behind a veil or keeping them chained up to the stove or anything like that. This is not white Sharia. This is not Islam. We are not calling for the subjugation of women. We're calling for the empowerment of women in their traditional roles as homemakers and mothers and people who are involved in the public, the society at large, because it takes an entire community to raise children responsibly, and women have a very important role in that. You know, this is, I hate to say respect women's, but, you know, there is a certain amount of respect that traditional men must have for the mother of their children. We don't wish to enslave women. This notion is absolutely ridiculous. I'm not going to say that it's full-on feminist empowerment, you know, freedom to do whatever you want to. You know, it's just a recognition of your inherent role as a woman in our societies, you know, this sort of traditional role. You know, we all have a part to play in this dance of life, and we want to preserve that because it is going to help us preserve our societies, our cultures, our religions, our people, so on and so forth. So I think this is a bit of a ridiculous question. This is not Islam. This is not white Sharia, as some people like to think that they have made a funny response. It's just simply not the case. And if you ever speak to traditional men and their views on women, you'll see that it's not liberal per se, but it's not about the enslavement of women at all. So hopefully you found that video enjoyable or informational in some way, shape, or form. If you did, leave me a like down below. You can go to the About section of my channel and find places to interact with me on Discord and Twitter. And thanks for listening.